Hello again. So to get you to appreciate, you know, how the starts look like, we put together this of the last election results for you. Watch this. Well, indeed, those are the statistics from the South Tongu constituency. We have the candidate, two of them in the studio. I will introduce the incumbent MP on the ticket of the NDC and the NPP candidates, Kobla Mensah Woyeme. Good morning to you and welcome to the show. Good to have you to join us as well. And also Seth Agbe, the NPP parliamentary candidates for the constituency. I'll give you both 2 minutes to introduce yourselves and then we'll start with what your constituents expect of you. So I'll start with you since you're the incumbent MP. And that would be your camera, the camera facing the middle. The middle camera will face.
Yeah. Very well. Yeah. Thank you very much for the opportunity. All and right. Good morning to viewers and more especially my constituents. My name is Kobla Mensah Woyeme, the current Member of Parliament for South Tongu constituency. And I must say the current parliamentary candidate on the ticket of NDC, hoping to be elected for the next parliament to continue the good work that had been started. I want to just pause here.
Okay. Did you grow up in the constituency? How long have you been in the Volta region? What do you think makes you stand out in the region, if you can add that?
Well, I must say my working experience in the region has been quite interesting. I've had a lot of opportunities in the past to have supported my the family's NGO headed by my senior brother, Women Foundation for Africa, that has actually extended some support to a number of communities, and more especially in the South Tongu district. We were able to do some water projects and supported, hospitals to, you know, function well in terms of supporting them with some logistics. And we have supported people, paid school fees and supported, the vulnerable people, the needy, couldn't support themselves. So I must say, this has actually provided opportunity for me to be actually well known in the region and then more especially in the district.
All right.
And so that has been it.
Thank you very much. Also to you, Mr. Seth Agbe, if somebody asks, you know, who are you? What would you say to them? That's your camera. Okay, that's your camera? That's your camera right there. All right.
Good morning to the church viewers at home, South Tongu constituency. And I'm very big thanks to TV3 for giving us this opportunity to be here today. My name is Seth Kosi Agbe.
Okay.
Native of Fievie, traditional area.
Okay.
From South Tongu.
South Tongu. Okay. What else do you do in the constituency before you became a parliamentary candidate? What the people say, homebred? I mean, are you from the place?
Yes. I'm born and bred in Singapore. So I start in South Tongu.
Okay.
Yeah. So first, I joined the New Patriotic Party since 1991. But then it was not given the name NPP.
Okay.
It was Dangwa Buzia Club. From there, 1992, they named the party as New Patriotic Party. I became the first organizer of the party, 1992 to 2004. 2008, I became a treasurer.
Okay.
As of now. So Last year, I was appointed as a parliamentary candidate.
Okay.
To lead them to and seat my brother in 2016.
Okay. So you didn't contest?
I contested.
You contested, and
I
then
contested
you.
Mr. Dawko.
Okay, all right. Thank you. Thank you very much for that. We'll get to, you know, specific things. You've said a number of things about, you know, how you pay people's school fees and the like. For people who find themselves in that constituency, tourism is such a big deal. What have you done, you know, in the 3 terms that you've had that has helped in promoting tourism in your constituencies?
Thank you. When I became the Member of Parliament, in fact, long before then, we've always had known the potential the area holds. And more so, too, you would notice that even the geographical location itself is an added advantage. We are on the West African, Trans-West African, or the ECOWAS road, and somewhat midway between two major cities in ECOWAS, Lome towards the east and Accra on the west. And you will notice that the traffic on the road is quite high. Then we are also lucky to have this natural resource, you know, I mean, passing through or flowing through that has actually several tributaries cutting beautifully in the land. And that is the River Volta, the lower, which is emptying itself at Dazizanu and at the estuary.
And you have a minute to wrap up from
that. That is one thing we've always seen and realized that, yes, it holds a very huge potential for tourism. And that is why we think there's a need to provide a basic infrastructure to be able to attract many more investments into that area. And so that has been what we've been driving at and we're working at all this while.
All right, for you, the same question for you about what have you done that you think has helped in driving or promoting tourism and getting more attention for the constituency?
Okay, as you said, South Tongu has been positioned as a vital geographic position, in terms of the river Volta, the hotels,
okay,
the water view, the spa, that's the Holy Trinity, Cicero's Hotel. They are the places that we can use our tourism.
Okay.
People came there to cruise on the river, to the estuary. Yes, that's what I can say.
Okay, have you been able to do anything? Have you been able to engage the people? I mean, what in your own way do you think that we can do to enhance it? Because we went to your constituency, we spoke to a number of people and they talk about job creation, for instance. Yeah. So we wanted to know if you've done anything in that regard.
Actually, I have not done anything in connection with that.
Okay.
But I do advise people.
Okay.
Let's say, for instance, before the Trinity Hotel came to existence,
okay,
I supported Dr. Anya. I'm a draftsman, a surveyor.
Okay.
So I supported him to have that plot to build on it.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much. I want to get to some specific things that when TV3 went to your constituency and then we discovered that the reservoir there is not working. And so people fetch from the Volta River. They are using it to cook. They are using it to clean. Aren't you concerned? Why haven't we fixed that?
The truth is, we've had some challenges with the reservoir and we've tried to work at it, and somewhat there'll be some problem with funding, but it's been fixed as we speak today. And currently what we are having as a problem now is at the source, the treatment plant. The pumps that are working are supposed to be working for us and getting the water pumped to the various tanks for distribution had broken down, and they've actually gone ahead and began procuring some to get them replaced. And so it's a challenge, but
it's not important to you?
It is. We've been speaking about it. So what we do in our small way is to get some tanker services and in the meantime the fire service to be helping and move getting water from the treatment plant itself to some of the communities that are in dire need. that are quite also far away from the river. But I must say there's a comprehensive plan towards solving the problem of water supply to the people of the
what
area.
What is that plan?
We have been captured in the plan to treat water and extend same to Lomé. And that, we believe, according to what has been done so far, may start this year. That we are aware that when it's going to be treated in Suakope and then piped all the way to Lomé. And along the route of the pipe, all communities there will be given access or to the water. That we believe will solve the problem. But now we are also trying to see how, even though we have agreed, the two districts, South Tongu and Central Tongu, have agreed in principle to get supply from Central Tongu to serve some of the communities that are near. And that we are already discussing it up to the ministry level for them to come in and support that, because there has been some budget raised to that effect.
All right. Yeah,
so that is what it is. And I know it will not be too long. Either of this would come in to sort of lessen the burden currently the way we are faced with, so far as water supply is concerned.
Okay, Mr. Agri, same for you about the water situation there, where people are fetching from the Volta River. They are using it to bathe. I saw people were using it to bathe. They're cooking from it. I mean, that's got to be so tough to watch that on TV. And then what would you do differently then?
It's a very serious issue on the ground. This the tank, the breakdown of the tank, it's causing a lot of problem in the community in terms of water supply. As I'm speaking now, I've visited to about four communities. So I'm providing a well. So yesterday they called me and they will start.
Four communities, you're providing a well from whose pockets?
From my own pockets. Because let's say, for instance, Dendu in one of our communities. About 5 months ago, they have no water to drink, no potable water. So some of them have started digging well for them.
Okay. He's your MP. Did you approach him? Did you tell him?
About the...
The water situation.
Yes, I'll be attacking him. You can ask him. I mean, the breakdown of the reservoir. Mm-hmm. I always attack him. I mean, his own community at Fabian Dugama. There's no water. Mm-hmm. I've been telling him. You can bear me a witness.
What reasons does he give to that? Pardon? As to why they've been unable to resolve it?
Is that because of money? It's not financial support. So
okay, all right. You also said that. Just 30 seconds, please. Just 30 seconds.
Thank you. Groundwater over the years have been found not to be too good to be sunk in that area. You do so, after a while, the water gets salty and very hard and totally unusable. There was a well sunk at the district hospital, for instance. That over a period is no longer good for them to use. So recently, there was an idea to get a reverse osmosis, machines, installed to help them treat the water. And as a result, I gave them, to support that process, out of, I think, a budget of about 30,000, 15,000, check, about a week ago, for that to be done. So, if he had come to me, to probably inquire about why we could not go that line, I would have given him probably with documentary, proof. But the answer to our problem is piping and distributing the treated water from the various treatment points, either from Central Tongu or from Agodome in the South Tongu.
And why haven't
and
you
that,
done that?
That is, we've been doing it. When we came, that is when I came, I assumed the seat, in 2009, the statistics, roughly.
That's
yes, was about 30, yes. And as we speak, we've extended distribution network to over 70. And we are still adding up.
But you've actually exceeded your time. I have to move on. Do you want to respond to any of that? Yes, go ahead, respond.
Yeah, as you were saying, if you go to Achieve, he asked the people of Achieve to dig a trench up to Dabagonshi for the... for a pipeline to play. As of now, nothing has been done about it. If you go to Agotakpo, The same thing happened there. You haven't done anything about it. So I've taken initiative to start digging a well for them as a remedy.
Okay, I know you want to say something, but unfortunately,
quickly, that has not been that project has not been abandoned. That was with the people just this weekend.
But you haven't done it.
Oh well, the truth is that it appears to him that it's been abandoned. But the truth of the matter is,
because
that
I was there,
pipes have been ordered. I was there over the weekend, and I
on two occasions. They put that the whole up to now.
You know,
okay, all right, but in other words, the well that you're digging, I mean, from what he said, the well that you're digging will be. Will not bear any fruit because it will not be good for the people.
Some are not salty. That's what it's not salty. It's good drinking water. Very nice, very good.
I'll be happy to have that.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much. And he also said something. You said that the days when people thought that the NDC is a party for the evers are over and that NPP is a party that welcomes all. What do you think has changed? What do you think has changed?
Actually, in voter regions after the NDC have failed the people. Totally. They have failed. A lot of promises that they have given to the people, they couldn't fulfill them.
Give me some.
Let's say, for instance, the school feeding program.
Sure.
They promised the people of providing them, to expand the school feeding program. That's that now some of the schools have not benefited. And then the whole thing has collapsed. If you go there right now, even my church member, one of my church members went to work at Bakofa. She was sacked. I don't know why.
For the school feeding?
For the school feeding.
You wanted to respond?
Definitely, I want to react to that. In terms of expansion of the school feeding program, it should be truthful. Is my senior brother. When we came, we had only three schools, Agbakope, Tefle, and there's another community in Agbajakope also. Those were the schools we met. As we speak today, we have taken same program to close to about 35 schools. What do you call this? It's an expansion. And so he
but
should
if they're expanding, then they're not getting the food. Is that
no? I am hearing this for the first time on this program. Probably when I go back, I'll go and cross check because I've not received any reports that really suggest that the program is not really running well. So I don't know about that.
It's not working.
You can mention. Oh, I'm sorry. You can mention some schools that you know that have failed. I mean,
Those that have been. Where the program is running now that have problems.
Thank you very much. Yeah, some of the schools that are having problems.
Yeah, like Bakope, for instance.
Okay.
And then Tefle.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the two that I know.
Okay, all right. Mm. Yes, just a quick one.
In fact, I must be very sincere to say that. It is not right what you just said. Hotel, and they held a meeting. I asked, I inquired whether there was any problem. She said no. She's listening. She could just put in a text message across to you.
Okay, all right. But how about the NPP breaking through the voter region? He believes that it's a dawn of a new day, and people are beginning to move away from the traditional NDC ideas.
You realize the difficulty my brother was having actually telling what he thinks are the problem areas or the failures of NDC and etc. That for which reason we are not doing well in the voter region, so therefore we'll not make the marks. It's so difficult to say because that is not the truth. Do you compare, for instance, in the districts, my coming and working with the NDC government over the past 8 years, and then the lobbying that went on, we saw electricity extended from a number of 45 communities to well over 300 communities. That is something that you call failure. Then I beg to differ here. You are talking about schools that have been built from kindergarten, primary to JHS and SSS. And then various SSS in the district are having other infrastructure, complemented in terms of their numbers that are increasing. And so What are you talking about? These are positives that are being impacted on the people of the district. And for which reason, we are sure to make the marks. And now there are a number, all these things are called the basic infrastructure. These are to be laid to accelerate
to
development and employment in various sectors.
Oh, I know you want to react to what he said, so go ahead and react.
As he's saying, I said that these people are failed veterans, especially in South Tongu. In our Greek, in Volta region, in the South Tongu, we have a lot of farmers. We have promised them to give them the farming equipment, but no, they haven't given to them. The access roads, in every town, access roads are very vital. You cannot build a house without a door or a window. If you are developing a town, you have to provide access roads for the people. That's what I'm speaking. Suakope, you have not enough access roads. During the time I was at Suakope, I lead the opening of the access road in Suakope. In Dabala, you have schemes that we use to provide access roads for the people. But as now, nothing has been done. I think that should be an area that we have to concentrate on. Okay. Access roads.
Okay.
Is it then? Okay.
So that's what you are offering your constituents, that if you're given the opportunity, you would do you would do that for them. All right.
If you go to where the head of departments are, you go there. The place is bushy. No access route for them. The place is bushy. Very nasty. You cannot boast of anything.
But as the incumbent MP and going for the third time, I mean, he's not the only person echoing. There are people who are there who are complaining about the roads that are inaccessible. And so it shouldn't be a comfortable thing for you.
No, I'm sure some of you, definitely, you know, development is a continuous process. It's not something that one day you're able to solve every problem of the people. When you visit the district, you notice that there are works going on. I acknowledge that there are, you know, challenges so far as roads are concerned. And there have been, in fact, the last visit by the president to the Deba of Chiefs and People of Sokwe Traditional Area, he actually talked about some of these roads that definitely will be seeing some works beginning this year. That is to say, and meanwhile, there are others that are going on now that some were completed some years ago, I mean, 2-3 years ago. And so it's something that is continuous. And this is the reason why the people of the district will appreciate and have faith in us. That yes, you cannot give all the solutions at a time, but as we go in, at the pace at which we are moving, we will surely arrive and get all this done. Because they are very important and they are the catalyst for the accelerated development, including employment, in terms of attracting the needed investments in the area.
All right.
So already we have got.
Okay. Unfortunately, you've run out of time. That will take us to job creation. Now, you said that you're collecting data of hairdressers, of Okada men, and then when you're given the opportunity, you would explain or you would tell them your plans. What are your plans for hairdressers and Okada men?
Okay, I've designed a form for collecting data from Okada boys and then the hairdressers. Let's say, for instance, a JSS, SSHS student, right in Okada. No, I don't think it's the best. I don't think it's good for them to introduce themselves to that business. So what I plan to do is that when my government comes to power, and I'll be the president of Ghana, we are going to provide jobs for them. We push those people because they have skills.
They're working. And I mean, operating Okada is a form of employment. Hairdressers are skilled. So what is wrong with what they are doing now? And what better employment opportunities would you give them then?
Okada business is a very risky business. Very risky. You cannot continue risking their life. They have been dying. Even 4 days ago, you lost about 2 lives. Two. At the Sokwe barrier. You see, we cannot continue losing our brothers like that. Okay. We have to find a way of.
You said
them.
When Nana Addo-Dankwa wins and he comes to power, he'll be able to do that. So if Nana Akufo-Addo does not win and you happen to win the seat, does that mean you will not continue with that?
I will continue to help them in that way. Let's say, for instance, we are doing this police recruitment. So I said, when give me the note as an MP, I will use my protocol to feed them to the police and the army. That's what I will do.
But is that what they want to do? Maybe that's your plan for them. Have they come to you and said to you that they want to join the police? Is that what they are saying?
A lot of them.
But people are employed into the security agencies on merit, not because as an MP you have to influence. But that would not be good.
Sometimes it works. Sometimes it works.
So you're willing to break the law for them?
No, not the law. Okay. But you have skills. So let's say another issue about the hairdressers. And then the dressmakers. I designed a form for them collecting this data. Let's say, for instance, they have apprentices. Every year, every seamstress or a dressmaker, these apprentices come out of their under their wash and then come out, pass out. But still, they don't have any job to do. You see them selling at the bread market, chasing cars, selling. So what I tend to do for them is that we build a place for them, fix a machine there, and then...
And is that
them.
What they want? Is that what they say they want? Or that's what... Because if, even with the Kofi Boakye, the recruitment, Kofi Boakye has spoken against it, that the politicians are influencing the security system, and that's how we have the people, because we are putting people who are unqualified, and you want to be a member of parliament, and with that in mind...
We can recommend. MP can recommend, because I know my people. I know those who are good, those who are bad. So I don't think it's a crime.
Okay, all right. Thank you very much. As a member of parliament, I heard you say this, that people who sell on the streets, it's not wrong. Hawking is not wrong, but how you manage it. How do you convince somebody who is selling on the street with a scorching sun on them that it's a good job?
I mean, the point is this, at the end of the day, the reason why I said what I said was that because of the situations we have found ourselves in now, and it's better than getting yourself something doing in that manner, but not a permanent one. And if you care to know, I do meet them. In fact, I have various groups already that I meet from time to time, and also encourage them about, you know, taking advantage of whatever money they make to just go back to school, better their grades, and take advantage of the scholarship schemes that I have put in place that are helping people, and also getting people to go and then a job of their choice, go and learn, if it's tailoring, if it's whatever, you find them, you know, engaged in those, trained, and when they graduate, I give them the kits on the things that will let them start. For instance, it's well known in the district that I distribute, you know, setup packs, hair dryers, you know, hair dryers, tools, and machines, sewing machines. In fact, I'm going to have another program next month.
My question has to do with why you think it's okay for people to sell on the streets.
It's fine. You see, sitting at home doing nothing because of grades not good, okay, and they have to get themselves together either to go and rewrite those exams or maybe, you know, fend for themselves. So if they go on the street to sell bread, okay, and then at the end of the day, they know what they are about through constant communication, alerting them that, look, this is not a permanent thing. It's for a while. It's just a springboard. Get what it is. Take advantage of the things that we have. We pay school fees for them. We engage those who would want to rather, instead of pursuing to higher learning, we want to probably apply some trade. The opportunity exists. You do it, when you graduate, we give you what it takes to start, which we are doing. And so these are some of the things that we encourage them to do. And you know, we find it very, very important also to bring some of the white collar jobs there. That is why there's the need to provide a basic infrastructure, which we're doing, and we have done so much in the past.
Well, what do you think voter, your constituents, South Tongu constituency needs for the youth? What do you think they need in terms of job creation? What do you think they need?
Variously, one, some would want to, in fact, education, most of them, when you chat with them, they want to continue to higher learning, and so that the youth, most of them want to continue. Some would want to rather engage themselves in some kind of trade, which we have that opening for them to take advantage of, and they are doing so. It's not something that we are now about doing, we are doing. And so the point is this, Whilst we are doing all of that, we are taking, in fact, the good thing that can happen to voter regions and under this government. Now we are having the oil exploration work going to start pretty soon in the Keta Basin. And we see Sugarcope, South Tongu for that matter, going to experience the boom. And so we have started engaging the people, alerting them and telling them how they can strategically position themselves and take advantage of that. And where
so
we
how,
have to come
how,
in
how, how,
through what
how?
I've just mentioned. For
you
instance,
mentioned,
if
yes,
it's education,
education. So where is it? Are the schools there?
So, no, the point is providing means by which they can continue to pursue their dream, if it's in education. That is why I have currently, I support with the common fund, for instance, and some from my own pocket to go to school. And we have a number of students currently in the various tertiary institutions that we are paying their fees for. And the SHS, there's basic, levels. Aside that, there are those who come to you and say, MP, I have for school, no, but we want to maybe go in to learn something else. So we arrange, because there are garage owners, there are GABA associations, you know, who are taking care of hair, the seamstress. The people who take all these people and train them.
Okay.
And immediately they graduate, we provide them with a startup.
My question is industrializing the voter region. When you talk about the Greater Accra region, some say it's. I'm coming, please. It is cosmopolitan. You go to the Ashanti region, it's more opened up. But the voter region still remains very, very close knit because people say there aren't opportunities there. And that's why it is worth. So my question has to do with how you're going to industrialize, help, use your influence.
Let me.
And you haven't done that.
No, I was on it. And okay, fine. There is this other plan to have an area zoned, okay, and have an extension of the free zone facility extended there. And so that, because why? The advantage here is this. We have a connection, a first-class road to the port that vehicles can easily ply and come and go. And of course, we can also boost of skilled labor. And so if we zone an area and we say extend this free zone to that area, we can then attract. We have currently water, electricity, and all these basic things being extended to almost every nook and cranny. That is also an advantage to allow or provide the congenial nature to attract the various industries to sites there, right, and take advantage of the tax holidays and all that.
All right, thank you. Thank you. You wanted to
make
a quick reaction to his plans.
As you're saying that he's going to support there.
Going. I am still doing it. You are aware.
So you're going to do it. You're not going to do it. Let's say, for instance, you have a sport academy at Fege Dugama.
Mm-hmm. Who set it up?
But none of South Tongu, young, talented football players have access to that academy. So what are you saying?
Why?
If that he cannot do, so how can you promise these people now that he's going to provide them a job? Mm-hmm. If that's the important thing, they brought it for academy. But he's not able to fix anyone, one single person, that's an academy. So
what are the options? Yes, it's okay. You talk about what's your vision then?
Yeah, as an MP, you have to have an influence. You have to sit down with the management, and then we discuss about the welfare of your people. The talented footballers, you have to fix them there, so that you can also boast of a footballer coming from area.
Okay. Just a quick, yes. Quick
Thank you very much. In fact, what it is that there is that program, and there's that plan.
Going to start?
No, there is. Are you telling me that since the beginning or inception of this academy, we have not had anybody from South Tongu enrolled in it? Go there and verify.
Okay,
maybe the numbers that you are expecting is what you are then asking. Maybe so. It starts from somewhere. We'll have to go on and on. And so, in fact, there's a discussion between myself, Togbia Mango, to discuss a few things for Fivie Dugama.
Okay, all right. I'm going to come back to you. You mentioned that you use over 80% of your common fund on education in paying school fees.
That's right.
Why?
Yeah,
the government is supposed to have a free SHS. So has it failed in your constituency?
You realize that there are always user fees, because before you look at when you look at tuition, it's not what I'm paying for. You realize that when you scrutinize any typical bill that is brought before you, and after a genuine investigation to determine whether the person actually needs it or not, that is done by my people. And you come to the realization, yes, this person needs to support it. If you scrutinize, you realize that the bills always carry other items. And so those items would have to be paid for to enable the person to stay in school. And so when you realize that there's the need to do that, you go ahead and do it. There are times you have no choice but to dip your hands in your own pocket and do it. I'm not the only one. Many of the MPs do. And so we do this to kind of, you know, help the people.
Your constituency needs their reservoir fixed. So that they can fixed. If they are not healthy, how will they sit in the classroom then?
I appreciate that, because water is life, and it's an issue that is ongoing, and we are working at it. The reservoir currently is fixed. Let me tell you a little, you know, history. This reservoir and the entire water system was built some as far back in 1998 by Bywater. At the time, Sulagofe and its environment, we didn't have so much pressure in terms of demand.
Okay.
And so they looked at the situation then and provided something to take care of the situation at the time, without probably looking into the future to realize that it was going to grow at a very fast speed like this. And so that has not been worked on. And in fact, there's been a whole proposal to Ministry of Works and Housing, Water Resources, to come and then help, you know, improve on the system by laying additional pipe from the treatment plant to Sulagofe Township for distribution. The tank you see there was built as far back at that time, and they looked into the situation at the time. We need extra tank to really take care of it. But okay, we've been promised that all of this that we need will be well captured in a new project that is about taking off.
Right. If you had the opportunity, what would be the top three things that you would use the common fund for? And explain what in broader terms, how you intend to implement it.
Actually, South Tongu, we have 5 traditional areas. The Agavas, Fievias, Sopi, Tefele, and Hume. What I'm trying to do is that I want to be a human resource for South Tongu. So I'll use my common fund. Even my vision, my plans for South Tongu,
sure.
I want to support 2 brilliant students from each traditional areas. I'll give my support, give my common fund, part of my common fund to support them, to give them a scholarship for every year.
Okay. Yeah, that's education. What
education.
Else? So I said 3 areas that you'd consider.
Now, use part of my common fund to support those in agric farmers. I will support them.
How? In what area? I mean, in what sense?
To buy them the farming equipment, like spraying machines, etc. That's what I will do.
Are those the most important things to farmers? Is that what do farmers tell you? What are their concerns?
Yeah, their concern is the MP to support them in their farming activities. So I think providing those things to help them to expand their farms.
You want to do a quick rebuttal? And
yeah, thank you very much. I mean, having said about 80% of the common fund is used in education, doesn't mean that the other sectors have been left out at all. In fact, currently after engaging, for instance, the district director of agri services and having been part of the various discussions, to determine and know at first hand the problems confronting our people.
Okay.
We've been able to provide some support, some equipment, implements, cutlasses when the demand we give. Yes, the knapsack spray machines have been going. And in fact, some chemicals which they need to be able to prepare the land for each wind farming season.
Okay.
And so all of that we do. Thank God this time around we are seeing some huge mechanized agriculture coming in terms of the rice farming.
You keep saying they're
rice farming.
Because recently some farms, rice farms, were destroyed.
No, that was by the flood.
Yes.
Yes, but you know, it's bounced back. It's bounced back. Currently, you know, they are also, these are disasters that happen, but it's not to take them totally away from the farm or the land. They are back on the land and they are tilling the land, they are planting, and then they are expecting to even harvest. And he's aware. So two major farms. So we have even encouraged them to come up with an agrower scheme where they equip, train people who own their own land, till provide them with the inputs, and at the end, harvest, and then they strike differences, and then they take you. So that is happening now. And so you see many more going into rice farming. My plan, by the grace of God, is in no time, the percentage in terms of output, in terms of rice production in this country, will be so higher percentage should be coming from South Tongu.
Okay, and Mr. Abi wants to.
You always do this when during the what do you call farmers' days. Okay. You always support them during the farmers' days. Those have come out. It's not a regular thing I've been doing. That's what I know. Okay. You say if you're saying that you've been doing it, I don't know.
What would you do differently? What would you do differently then?
Yes, we have. You see, in South Tongu, we have a lot of farmers.
Okay.
So we need to support the farming. You know, farming is life. When we have food in abundance, we are okay. So we need to support our farmers, you know, our creations.
Yes. So specifically, what would you do? For instance, you said, yeah, let's support it. I think earlier you mentioned that you buy them the machinery that they need. But and then you accuse him of not visiting the farm. That's this only on Farmers' Day and the like. So what would be the plan that you have that would distinct apart from buying machines for them?
That's why I designed a form. I'm collecting the data to know the amount of farmers within each community.
And well, what's the data? What volumes, numbers? What numbers do you have? How many people have been able to register on your form to help you?
For now, we are about 500.
500 people. Mm. All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. Actually, I have a question from a viewer to the incumbent MP, and so I'm going to put that to you. He says, ask the MP, why have you sat down for people who live and trade along the banks to destroy the riverbanks?
Who live and trade along the riverbanks?
Yes.
Live and trade along the river.
People who find themselves, yes, who sell there. You don't know anybody who does.
Is it, for instance, by where the bridges, the barrier, because that's the only place I can really, you know, visually. Because along the river bank, you find people, hotels, and all these hospitality businesses
the place,
and all
yeah.
that. But even when, if you are talking about the hawkers, who are not even by so close to the river bank itself, but they are. If you know Sokakope very well, you realize that they share the barrier, the area of the barrier. So I'm not too sure about that. But the point is this, we can always look at it. I'll be happy to have this as a report. And they know, I've already operated an open door, you know, kind of thing. And my doors are wide open. So let's look at it. And if really it's an issue, we'll address it. Because trust me, one of the things I always tell the people and all over the community is that our assets, we need to protect and cherish so much, and that is what has made us who we are and so unique, of course.
Okay.
It's a river, and we've got to protect it, and pollution of it, we have to make sure we seriously prevent it, and where we have to prosecute, we will have to encourage prosecution. And so that is what it is. So we will look at it if that is what it is, but for me, I cannot really picture what exactly he's putting across.
Okay, all right.
The people selling along the riverbank, they have no option to go there.
Okay.
Because they have no place to go. They have no job to do. You see, those who have
come. But you know the place.
I know the place.
Where?
Specifically where? Because he said he can't put a picture.
Because
thing
if it's a barrier area.
It's a barrier.
Okay, all right.
The barrier. Oh, the barrier.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
Is it by the bank?
Please allow him. So, he said they have no choice but
they have
to
no choice to go there. Because if you don't go there, they can't. Have money for their living. They have to go there.
Okay. Yes. All right then. I also want to ask you this, that in terms of the numbers, it looks as if you are, it's a very, very uphill battle in terms of the numbers. Because if you look at the figures that we showed you earlier, from 82%, in fact, the president got the 92.393% in the last elections. as compared to some 6.9 thereabouts. What has changed, do you think has changed the last 4 years? And how do you intend to get the numbers behind you a few months to elections?
Now, voters in the South Tongu people, they are fed up with NDC. You see, I've been saying that when somebody is voting, in voter region, he's voting for the party, not a personality. So in terms of party, he said the voters, is for is their party, because our founder is from voter region.
Okay.
That's what we know, they know. But now, they have not seen that following the NDC at this time, there will be a failure. So they're not changing. So that's why we are saying change is coming.
Were you also an NDC before you became NPP?
No.
You've always been NPP?
Yes, since 91.
Okay, all right, thank you. Thank you very, very, very much as well. Also, a lot of people say that because it looks like, you know, a safe seat, you are complacent, and so you don't necessarily address the needs of the people only during the election that you're seen around. How would you respond to that?
That is totally wrong. I'm sure my brother here will attest to the fact that I visit home every weekend.
I have always organized
town hall meetings, and we've always, you know, this is where somehow you take the wants and needs of the people along as an MP and articulate same in parliament in their interest. And so the town hall meetings are constantly organized by me, but for the people, and I've never, been absent continuously, say, 3 weeks from the constituency since I became member of parliament.
Do you also do town hall meetings?
Myself?
Yes, no. You don't. No. So how do you get to the people? How does your message get to them?
I visit them.
Oh, you visit them. All right. Thank you.
Now, as he's saying, last I was accusing him.
Okay.
After his primaries, my brother switched off his phone. When I was going around, the people attacked me. So it's like, are you also going to do the same thing? When you voted for you, then you switch off your phone. I said, that's what my brother is doing. He said, no. As a leader, we don't switch your phone. How can the people get in touch with you? He said, thing. So, for saying that you have been coming, sometimes you will come and hide inside his room. So I will beg of him that from now, you should be coming out.
Thank you.
We're able to feel him.
Thank you. I will do as you wish so that you can join me.
I want to ask you something very serious. You know, I'm sure you all in the country where you heard Difa Atibo's comment when she visited the community, appealing to indigenous to vote for President John Mahama because if the NPP came to power, they were going to prosecute him. What did you think?
I listened to the original tape.
Okay.
Right, in ever. The woman did not say what was transcribed in English.
What did she
say? In any case, the woman was simply admonishing the people, the audience, through what I would consider a historical account. History is studied at school. What is the essence of history at school? We study history to be able to guide ourselves into the future. And so, stepping from that, I have no problem at all, you know, because these were things that happened. And as they happened, they ought to be told. They ought to be orally, you know, communicated, probably even written for people to come and see later.
But what has she done wrong to fear an NPP victory, meaning that she would be prosecuted and jailed?
What she said was not per se referring to herself.
What did she say? She said,
look, do you want to see us? Us, ever.
So she's one of them.
Like us. I mean, what are you talking about?
Okay, hold on.
Then she mentioned like Fifi Kwete and maybe others. For instance, going to, being jailed. As it happened in the past. Because, you see, it is not about herself. In any case, has she been indicted in anything, any wrongdoing now?
Thank you.
I don't think she has been indicted. And so she has not done anything wrong. She's just telling Ghana, more especially NDC, that let's get up, go out there,
you know,
all right, thank
and
you.
Do
thank
what we need to do to protect the interests of the NDC.
You listened to the original tape. What exactly did she do? You remember?
I mean, you put a twist to it because that is the
first of all, what I want to say is that it's a saying. If you are not stealing anybody's fowl, when they stand right, you don't panic. But when you have stolen somebody's fowl and then the standard is striking, you begin to fear. So Yusufa Atiwa is afraid of his own shadow. She's afraid. What have you done? To say, the NDC is for the Rotarians, our founder is Jerry Rawlings, so the party is for the ways. So therefore, vote for
the
NDC.
No, the party is for a cast across.
This is what she said.
It's a national party.
This is what she said. This is what she said.
It's a national party.
The NDC is for Rotarians, therefore they should vote for the NDC.
So your if comments, not, your, if, pardon? Yeah, so you condemn that? What
yes,
do you think?
I condemn it. Okay. You see, it's not good. If you haven't done anything, why should you begin to fear? You don't fear, entertain the fear. Be bold. After all, when they find you liable, they will send you to court. The judge should go into the case and then judge if you are liable, you will send you to prison. That is all. Right. So you shouldn't entertain the fear.
Thank you. Thank you both. Before we wrap up, though, I want you to look into this camera here and speak to your constituents in your language, in your local language, on why they should vote for you. Yeah, so this camera is for you.
Nokomadima Globe and South Tongu Tobe said Kosiak B. Minyam who may be Minyam. Name a Tao one of your call, a Tao and a South Tongue, Minye. Tamadi to me, Bobby, a fortune. Funya edit them, and you are talking about over if you need to go. Ta, my dear, I'm your fortune, never me vote to man. Ya Pomia change, South Tongue. I'm your adroit when you are no one did you know? You told me you're a soft tongue. Two of you told me to go with Tiger I'm a truck more. I'm Mamma, let me miss you. Mamma, miss you. I'm Mankuta, let me miss you.
Thank you. Thank you, Akpanami. Yes, please. You look into this camera and tell us why you they should give you the money to continue what you're doing.
Yo, akpe ne novinyo le safton abale mi nto mi nyane mi je do arogo me pe nyare vai gomodo po le bo wano yin mi aga trilogy mi nya te po yo akanemeno akaneva mi nya te po yo chimeno mi chochi koyi afi mi galeji mi tin anu okata o gesere ka akamata ajide puno no mi esi suku ho mi letum Eji komigale omo ha mi le do
cover
yeah my brother enugere the vio ice pito kata oha maka jo mi la gba je lo kata onti medibe mi kata mi a wodeka lenti fa fam
all right
adogbara ne mi a he mi no je cover me de me wa pele mi nti ala be go le menyo e mi aye le ngo lenti fa fam amen
thank you very much but this is just outside of the point before we go you're from the same constituency you're contesting yeah. So I want to how did you come? Did you drive separately or you came together?
He's in Accra.
He came
all the way from the water region. Okay, thank you very much for coming and our greetings to the people of South Tongu constituents. We hope that this has helped you better understand and appreciate the vision of the parliamentary candidates. A big thank you to the incumbent MP for South Tongu, Kobla Mensah Woyome, and also Ted Agbe. He's aspiring MP for South Tongu on the ticket of the New Patriotic Party. Good morning to you, gentlemen.